So the next speaker this morning is Keiji Saito from University, and he will tell us on rigorous bounds on energy absorption in periodically driven many-body quantum systems.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm Keiji Saito from Keio University in Japan. And today I'll talk about some rigorous result on periodical driving system, nonequilibrium system. 2 days ago, Arnab Das talked about similar topics. But in my talk, we will talk about some rigorous result in nonequilibrium systems, and especially on the relaxation process is explained. Collaborator, these people from Tokyo University, Kuwahara and Mori. From my talk is the following. First, we explain about the recent relevant experiment which motivates us. And because we are talking about thermalization in periodically driven systems, we talk about ETH and flow ATH next, and roughly explain about the mathematical framework, which is a flow theory and flow magnetic expansion. And introducing models, we explain our results. Okay, so let me roughly explain about recent relevant example of experiment. First example is a discovery, demonstration of a flow topological state, which was done by Etehaz group in Zurich. And they used the cold atomic system, which is on optical lattices. And they applied a periodical modulation with some technique with the piezo, and they changed the system parameter between lattices, and they make the effective Hamiltonian. And the effective Hamiltonian is a Harrodian Hamiltonian. I don't explain about Harrodian Hamiltonian, but the important thing that grand state of this Hamiltonian is a non-trivial topological phase, topological state. Then important thing, an interesting thing, is that periodical driving field changes the macroscopic state. And this modified macroscopic state seems to be stable, at least during experimentally measurable time scale. Another interesting experiment is the discovery of Higgs mode in the superconductor. And this was done by Tokyo University's group. They applied periodical driving laser fields. They applied strong laser field on superconducting material, and they detected the oscillation of order parameter in time. And this oscillation is reflected from the mode, which is perpendicular to the Nam-Goldstone mode. And this mode is called Higgs mode in this community. And the interesting thing is that, again, that modified macroscopic state, in this case, oscillating macroscopic state, looks very stable, at least during the experimental measurable time scale. Then this is very interesting in the sense of a solid state. And I think it's interesting even in the sense of statistical physics, because if we apply periodical driving field on the macroscopic material, we expect that system will heat up and the temperature of the system will eventually goes to infinity. In spite of this expectation, macroscopic states, modified macroscopic state driven by periodical driving field seems to be very stable. Then we felt that something deep inside, then we decided to study on this topic in the sense of statistical physics. Okay, so as I said, we expect some heating process if you apply periodical driving field on macroscopic material. Then it is highly related to the topic of thermalization. In the key ingredient in thermalization, especially for a non-driven case, is ETH. ETH is an eigenstate thermalization hypothesis, and this means that each eigenstate is indistinguishable from microcanonical ensemble. For instance, in your many world system, only energy is a conserved quantity. Then, and we take one eigenstate from the Hamiltonian, and we expect, we look at the expectation value of local observable O. Then ETH tells us that expectation value of local observable is equivalent to the value calculated from microcanonical ensemble or canonical ensemble. In the case of a canonical ensemble, beta is chosen by comparing the expectation value of energy. Okay, so the extension of ETH to driven case is possible, and it's called Fluke ETH. In driving system, in driven systems, even energy is not conserved quantity, and we expect that wave function visits any phase space, and at steady state, is expected to be random state. And in other words, the steady state should be a state of infinite temperature as a result of heating. And in the language of Fluke theory, the Fluke eigenstate should be almost all eigenstate of Fluke operator is
steady
in the long time limit. Steady state in the long time limit, I mean. Not quasi state. I explained the example. Let me show you some example by demonstrating by looking at toy model. Okay, so we look at this toy model. Okay, this is a very simple model. Capital T is a period, and the sigma is a Pauli matrices. And in this model, for a first half period, Hamiltonian is Ising model. And the next half period, Hamiltonian is simply Zeeman term in x direction. I don't think it's realistic at all, but I don't care the reality. And because it's advantageous in the numerics because it's easy to calculate in numerical calculation. And we expect that this tells us some essential physics. And we set all spin down state as initial state. And we consider the time evolution of the expectation value of Z component of a spin variable at first lattice. Then I said, Fluke ETH means a state of infinite temperature expected as a steady state in the long time limit. Then if it's satisfied, expectation value of any spin operator should be zero. Then from this, we can check if Fluke ETH is satisfied or not. Okay, so this is a result using this toy model. Okay, so, x-axis is time, and y-axis is expectation value of a spin variable. And as you see, this blue and purple and value is saturated to finite value. This occurs only for a small system size. On the other hand, if you increase the system size, this expectation value goes to zero. This is a one indication of Fluke ETH. The important thing that this kind of thermalization occurs only for large system size, sufficiently large system size. Okay, this is what I meant.
Value you see is that the plateau,
but it eventually goes to zero.
You
are saying about this?
Sorry?
You are saying about this part?
Yeah, or say the purple one below
that. Yeah, but I don't know. I don't simulate long time limit. But I think it looks very stable. And this saturation occurs only for small system size. But if you increase the system size, it goes to zero. I think this never goes to zero because it's small system size. Okay, so now again we look at the same graph. So this is a demonstration of Fluke ETH. And now we want to look at the initial relaxation process. Okay, so this figure A is a relaxation to random state at large time scale. And we want to look at the very initial stage of relaxation here. And this is a very beginning of stage of relaxation. And this is a bit larger time scale. In figure C, we plotted many cases of period to compare the stability. So if you look at the figure B, the initial decay is obtained. Since I set all down state as initial state, this value starts from minus one. And immediately after time evolution, this value goes to some constant, not constant, but almost constant. And this means that this indicates that the wave function, the state decays to some state. And this state lasts for a while in transient time scale. So this, from this graph, we expect that three time scale exist in the relaxation. Initial decay and transient dynamics, and which looks stable, and at much larger time scale, float ATH is satisfied. This is the scenario. And this stability in the transient time scale seems to depend on the period. Okay, so now explain the question. As the toy model shows, time separation in the dynamics and the relaxation is anticipated in periodically driven many body system. And I guess that this will be highly related to the stability of transient dynamics measured in experiment. And because of a lot of experiments nowadays, clarifying the stability of the transient regime is crucial. Then the detailed question is the following. What is the origin? What is the origin of the stable transient regime in the relaxation? And what another question is, as I showed, the transient regime depends on the frequency period. Then the question is, what is the period dependence of the transient time scale? Okay. Okay, so since we are looking at periodically driving systems, most important mathematical framework is Floch theory. Okay, so this is a unitary time evolution matrix, and capital calligraph T means the time ordering operator. And since this is a unitary matrix, you can write in this way. And HF is an effective Hamiltonian, which has all information in the dynamics. And capital T is a period. And this HF is called Floch Hamiltonian, the most important target in the dynamics. Once you get the Floch Hamiltonian, you can analyze everything in the periodically driven dynamics. Okay, so HF has the eigenstate and the eigenvalues, and the eigenvalue is within some finite regime. And Floch ETH is interpreted in this framework as follows. almost all eigenstate of Floch Hamiltonian is random because energy, or even energy, is not conserved. That is a statement of Floch ETH in this context. Once you get Floch eigenvalue and eigenstate, you can write quantum state, arbitrary time, which is integer times period, like this, in this way, with some constant determined by initial state. Oh, okay, so as you see, and this is a time evolution, and you can expand by Taylor expansion with time ordering. And by applying logarithmic to this, you can get H effective, Floch Hamiltonian. And by expanding logarithmic term, formally you can get the expansion expression of Floch Hamiltonian.
Have to divide
here.
Yeah, I'd like to see that divided by one of the
capitals. But
oh, no, it's on the left side.
Yes. By using the formal Taylor expansion, you can get formal expansion for flock Hamiltonian like this. This is called the Magnus expansion. Very formal. You see a very complicated structure. For instance, zeroth order of flock coefficient looks like this, simply given simply by the average of time-dependent Hamiltonian like this. The first order looks like this, given by the commutator. And the higher order is very complicated. And several properties follows. First is this expansion is very formal, simply using the Taylor expansion. And the next important thing is that higher order has multiple commutators. And because of this complex structure, higher order is highly non-local in space. And the most important thing is that, in general, for large system size, this is not convergence is not guaranteed mathematically, and it diverges generally. So to get some feeling about divergence, we roughly estimate of the upper bound of each coefficient. As I said, the Flock-Magnus expansion is formally given, and using the formula, we can get an upper bound like this with a multiple commutator. And using this simple inequality, which varied in arbitrary A and B, you can get an upper bound like this. Using upper bound, rough estimation of convergence is ensured when this condition is satisfied. Actually, this condition is very hard to satisfy because this is a norm of Hamiltonian, because we are thinking of many body system, large system size, and this can be very large. Unless period is very extremely small, this cannot be satisfied. So this is why we expect divergence. This is a schematic picture of the norm of each coefficient as a function of order. And it's easy to demonstrate this divergence of Flock-Magnus expansion using toy model as used so far. Again, the simple model, first half period easing type, and next half period, Zeeman component in x direction. And to demonstrate the divergence of Flock-Magnus expansion, we introduce truncated version of Flock-Hamiltonian like this. This is given by summing up to nth order. This is very simple. And this is a result, numerical result of divergence of the Flock-Magnus expansion. This is in this graph, norm of the each order of Flock-Magnus expansion is given as a function of the order. You see for the case of t equal 1.5, the size, norm of the coefficient becomes smaller up to a certain order. Immediately after this order, it becomes much larger. This is a very general tendency. And in the context of truncated Flock Hamiltonian, divergence is clear like this. So in general, I want to emphasize that Flock-Magnus expansion is divergent. But we have no mathematical proof. It's empirical evidence. But we believe that, in general, Flock-Magnus expansion is divergent in large system size. And typically, this kind of structure is given. And actually, the divergence of Flock-Magnus expansion is not merely mathematical, but very physical, because from the flock ETH, almost all flock eigenstate is a random state. That and the flock, true flock Hamiltonian is also kind of random matrix. to get kind of random matrix, higher order of expansion necessary. Higher order of coefficient is necessary because originally Hamiltonian is regular Hamiltonian. To get random matrix, we need higher order coefficient in Flock-Mangalore expansion. That means the norm of the higher order coefficient must be large. So from this divergence of Flock-Mangalore expansion, it's highly related to the heating effect physically. And this, looking at this kind of picture, this reminds us of mathematically asymptotic expansion. You see, the asymptotic expansion is divergent if you use the full expansion. But asymptotic expansion, truncated expansion, accurate, very accurate to describe physics. We expect the same thing in this expansion. The idea is that we use truncated Hamiltonian to describe transient dynamics, and we want to capture the stability of transient dynamics using this. This is the idea. Okay, so as I said, true Flock Hamiltonian is a very non-local Hamiltonian because of Flock ETH. But truncated version of Flock Hamiltonian is local because we take up to certain order. Then we expect transient dynamics should be explained by this truncated Flock Hamiltonian. Okay, so let me explain our model. Our model is very general, but it's better to start with a very simple model as an example. As an example, this is a spin chain. And the toy model that we used so far is categorized into these spin chains. And the important condition is the following. This has at most two body interactions. And another important thing is that energy for one side is bounded. This is a very key ingredient in our model. In our general setup is the following. Mathematically written like this, but the key impose the two conditions. One first condition is K-local. K-local means Hamiltonian contains at most K-body interaction. In this example, spin chain, K equals 2 because it contains at most two body interactions, K equals 2. And we impose another condition, that is a G extension. We call G extension. It's not a familiar terminology, but we call it G extension. This means energy per one side is bounded from above and smaller than G. And obviously, for the case of spin chains, energy per one side is bounded as long as J and H is finite. This is a very important condition in our model. As long as these conditions are satisfied, we can prove rigorous result. Let me explain our result, which contains three points. The first result is that we have existence. We can show that existence of quasi-conserved quantity in K-local and G-extensive driven system with a period T. What is a quasi-conserved quantity? Quasi-conserved quantity is, in fact, truncated Flock Hamiltonian of N0th order. And N0 is a maximum integer smaller than this value. And this value is given by GKT. G means G extensive. Energy power one side is bounded by G. And K means K local. And capital T is a period of driving. And because capital T comes in denominator, this is roughly speaking proportional to the frequency. Omega is the frequency.
Okay.
Not KBT, sorry.
And what about the dimensions?
This is integer. Actually, this is integer. Sorry, H bar and KBT is 1 in my calculation. So, slightly misleading. Yes?
No, I'm not talking about
Yes, somewhere
oh, sorry, okay.
Numerator or
G is energy.
G is energy,
oh, G
yes. Energy. Yes. And H bar or KB
yeah.
or somewhere. Sorry. And roughly speaking, this is proportional to the frequency. And if you put very large frequency in the system, this can be large. And the statement is the following. This truncated Fourier Hamiltonian, it behaves like a quasi-concept quantity, which lasts exponentially long time with respect to frequency. Mathematically, you can write in this way. This is a Fourier Hamiltonian, and it's in zeroth order Fourier Hamiltonian, truncated Fourier Hamiltonian. And this is a time evolution of this, this operator. And the normal difference between this is bounded from above like this. And you see the 2 to the power n zeros appear in the denominator. And as I said, n zero is a order of frequency. Then if you put large frequency here, then you can write in this way. This means that this truncated Fourier Hamiltonian behaves like conserved quantity. And this conserved quantity holds during exponentially long time with respect to frequency. This is the one result. And another result is that heating process is suppressed during exponentially long time with respect to frequency if you put very large frequency. Mathematically, you can write in this way. H0 is an unperturbed Hamiltonian, and H0t is a... H0t is a Heisenberg... H0t is a... time evolved, H0t is the time evolution in the Heisenberg picture. And this normal difference between this is bounded from above like this. Again, this kind of structure appears. This means that H0 is almost constant during exponentially long time. This is the second result. And third result is about the relaxation process. As I explained in the introduction, conserved quantity is very important in the thermalization. If you have a conserved quantity in energy, the thermalized state is given by microcanonical state or canonical state. Then now we have the quasi-conserved quantity, then we expect some relaxation. In relaxation, this conserved quantity is very important. And as I said, we showed existence of quasi-conserved quantity. Then initial state should relax onto the thermalized state. Thermalized state determined by this quasi-conserved quantity. This is a parallel to the philosophy of ETH. And as I said, this quasi-conserved quantity lasts during exponentially long time. This is the transient dynamics. And at much larger time scale, Fourier ETH should be satisfied, then system gradually heat up to infinite temperature. This is our scenario. Okay, so now again we look at the same graph I showed before. This is the Fourier ETH at large time scale. And this is a very beginning stage of relaxation. This is the initial decay. Since I set all down state as initial state, it starts from minus one. And this initial state decays to some state, thermalized state, determined by the quasi-conserved quantity. And this thermalized state lasts for a while. This is a transient dynamics. And after that, Fourier ETH is satisfied in much larger time scale. Okay, the question is whether this time scale, in this time scale, thermalized state is satisfied or not. Okay, to convince you, let's look at the reduced density matrix for the displays, which contains only 6 spins. Total system is 24, and we look at the subsystem which contains 6 spins. And we know wave function here. And using this wave function, we can construct a reduced density matrix for this subsystem. And we check whether this reduced density matrix is canonical or not. So you see, this is a result of the reduced matrix. This is the x-axis, y-axis is the diagonal element of the reduced density matrix, and the x-axis is the eigenvalue. And since y-axis is logarithmic scale, and it's almost straight, that means exponential, then we check that, we realize that this is thermalized state. Okay, so with a huge slide, we explain rough outline on the proof of the existence of a quasi-conserved quantity. But the basic inequality is important. As I said, two conditions is very important, K-local and G-extensive in our Hamiltonian. G-extensive means energy per one site is bounded by G, and K-local means Hamiltonian contains at most K-body interaction. Suppose operator A is a KA local and GA extensive, and B also similarly KB local and GB extensive, then you can show easily this inequality. The norm of this commutator is bounded from above in this form using GA and KB and this norm. And using this inequality, we can show that you can show basic lemma. Set a period capital T, which is smaller than this value, then you can show this inequality for the operator, which is I plus one times K local operator. And this first term is a real-time evolution And the next term is approximated time evolution using truncated Bloch Hamiltonian. And the normal difference between these is bounded from above in this form. So to prove this theorem, we use Dyson expansion. As I said, we want to compare real time evolution and approximated time evolution. And this time evolution can be expanded by using the Dyson expansion. And here L is a commutator using real Hamiltonian. And approximated version using truncated Bloch Hamiltonian is also expanded like in this way. And integration over time is necessary here. And L tilde is a commutator with a Bloch coefficient. And comparing these, and also using the inequality that I explained in the previous page, you can find the upper bound like this. And in this way, you can get the theorem. And finally, plugging Bloch Hamiltonian itself into the operator O, you can get the existence of a quasi-conserved quantity like this. This is a rough story to get the quasi-conserved quantity. Okay, let me summarize. Motivated by several experiments, stability of transient dynamics was investigated, and we used the a very general model, where we imposed two conditions, K local and G extensive. Then we get rigorous proof of the existence of a quasi-conserved quantity. And heating process also suppressed during exponential long time, which is as long as you put very large frequency. And based on the quasi-conserved quantity, general relaxation scenario, which contains three time scale, is expected. This is a completely parallel concept to the ETH. Thank you for attention.
Yeah, I have two questions. Probably you mentioned this. So what decides the time scale for this transient dynamics? So to start with, in the Hamiltonian, we have two time scales. One is the period, then you have the 1 over j.
Yes.
Yeah. So what decides the time scale for the transient dynamics?
Yes, this is time scale is given by the energy of Hamiltonian, which is g,
yeah,
and frequency, and there is the most of roughly proportional to frequency. Huh. Then cannot say rigorously, but it's related. Yes, yes.
Yeah. Okay.
But as long as you put very large frequency, time scale is lower bound of time scale is exponentially large.
Yeah. Another is. You had some inequality where you had commutator of a comma b and you took the norm of it. Can you just show that to me?
Last part.
Yeah, in the last part. So I vaguely remember it. Huh, yeah, exactly this, yes. So it looks like highly asymmetric between a and b. If I interchange a and b...
Okay, this comes from the property of this comes from the property of K local and G extensive. It's a more severe condition than the usual inequality.
Okay, but let us say I put a minus sign there, meaning so minus in front of the a comma b, so within the norm, so then it will become b comma a, right? The commutator, is that the correct algebra or
yes.
Then so if I write, if I just interchange a comma b, it should remain the same, right?
Okay, it depends on the order. Order of commutation.
Okay.
Actually, yes.
Oh, it's not AB symmetric.
You can write in this way, but if you put B and A, then the expression is different.
Yes.
Yes.
But on the left hand side, is it the?
Yeah, both should be true. Yeah, both should be true.
Oh, okay. Both.
We take. Yeah. We take more larger upper bound.
Yeah. Exactly. Yes. Yeah. Thank you.
Sorry.
Yeah, it appears to me that if you change the frequency of the time-dependent part of your Hamiltonian,
yes,
you might hit some resonance frequency where the heating would be fast. Can you exclude that by your conditions, and can you study it?
This is a very important question. In my case, we don't think about such resonant phenomenon. Actually, in our estimation, we don't care about the interference effect in quantum dynamics. We simply look at the bound. We don't care about some resonance. Yes. So in a sense, it's overestimating.
Any other question?
So for the, if I just look at the system just for the transient period, it looks like some sort of steady state.
Yes.
Huh. Yes. Can one write down an effective flow K Hamiltonian just for that time? Is it same as that H naught in
true flow K Hamiltonian is very different from the truncated flow K Hamiltonian.
Yeah, so that truncated flow K Hamiltonian, does it represent the Hamiltonian for that transient time period?
Yes. That is what I demonstrated in the numerical calculation. Okay, so we look at the subsystem.
Yeah.
Using this truncated flow Hamiltonian, we express the resistance density matrix with the eigenstate of this truncated flow Hamiltonian, and we show the diagonal matrix element as a function of eigenvalues inside the subsystem. then this is the effective Hamiltonian, which is very local.
Okay. Thank you.
No other question? Well, I had a very naive question about your basic model, where you have two Hamiltonians, Ising Hamiltonian and the
other. Yes, toy model. Yes.
Toy model?
Yes.
Can you show it? Yes. So now the Hamiltonian here is constant during half the time.
Yes.
So in this case, can't you use a kind of Campbell-Hausdorff expansion or something like that? Something like that to come.
Okay. So maybe it's equivalent to the.
Because it's constant half the time, so.
Yes.
HF exponential HF is
yes.
Product of these two.
It might be true. Yes.
You didn't try that.
I never tried, but formally it's possible. Yeah.
It's just a suggestion. If there's no other question, we can thank Keiji again.
Thank you.
Half an hour.